Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Really, yesterday I was trying to have a look at Prague, but the rain really affected my excitement with the city, with the town. So let's get some excitement maybe today. Yes, as I understand, election observation, yes, of course, it's connected with so-called human dimension of security. Maybe it's not so exciting as military dimension. I think, as I understand, you are mostly related to military dimension activities. But still, I hope that there will be some interesting stuff for you. And I was asked, actually, to provide you with a general, I would say, mandate. Actually, I'm going to provide you a general mandate for election observation, which is provided for Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights, ODIHR, or we call it just ODIHR. Then I'll just describe, maybe not in very narrow details, the methodology, and actually we'll proceed to different types of election observation missions, election observation activities, and if there will be interest or request, we could actually proceed to more details how the missions function in the fields. So just see it. So actually, election department is a special unit in ODIHR, which is in charge of organization of all election observation activities within the OSCE region. There are not so many people actually. Maybe it's a pity. Only some 15, 16 people. But of course, the election observation activities are not provided exclusively by ODIHR staff or even yes, by ODIHR staff or personnel. But we are really involving and engaging a huge number of experts from different countries across the whole OSCE region. But this is also not the backbone of the observation activities. The main observation is provided by actually the people who are seconded by the OSCE participating states, and all of them are in our international experts database, and we use and try to encourage to promote their maybe interest in election observation activities every year. Maybe just a couple of words for this year, for 2015, we got the overall budget for election observation activities, 6.5 million euro. Which actually the figure is quite maybe essential, solid, but taking into account that we are usually observing some 15 up to 20 elections during the year, it's really a bit discouraging for us. But of course, nobody can be happy with any budget provided by states or any other person. Here, I think it is actually seen. Just I wanted to give you the geographical representation of election observation activities. This was the last year. Maybe you will notice that really this picture shows a bit small bias to the eastern part of OSCE participating region. But it was actually connected only because these countries declared and held their elections during the 2014 period. But actually, we are following and we are observing the elections across the whole region. And I would say that now, for example, we have... Oh, sorry. I should switch it off. Sorry. Now we have, for example, election observation in Turkey, in Albania. The mission is going, now the preparations are ongoing for election observation in Canada. We haven't been actually there for quite a long period, for 9 years, and this year we are going to observe the elections. From the very beginning we had already finished the observation in Tajikistan, in Kazakhstan. And we'll have several elections during this year. I think maybe you heard about the Ukrainian elections are expected to be held and to be observed in autumn. There will be elections in Belarus, in Kyrgyzstan, and some other countries, Croatia actually, and potentially everybody are speaking, maybe more rumors yet, but still there are some potential for early elections in former Yugoslavian Republic of Macedonia. So we are quite traveling quite a lot, as you can see. But why? Why do we observe actual elections? I think you know that the OSCE participating states actually committed themselves for certain respect for political freedoms, for respect of human rights. They decided, or not actually decided, but concluded that the human rights is one of the basis, one of the necessary basis for providing security, and not only within a specific country, but within the whole OSCE region. Besides the human rights dimension, we have military, political-military dimension of security, and actually economical and ecological dimension. But we are speaking about the elections, so there are several commitments, and I would say standards for democratic elections. We will follow it a bit later. But the main reason or the main aim is actually to provide, to assess whether the electoral legislation and especially electoral practice do comply with the commitments undertaken by the participating states. Actually, in some countries, not in all, of course, we provide and promote so-called preventive effect to deter potential, possible, quite often it happens in different countries, to deter possible fraud and intimidation of voters or any other types of pressure on contestants, on political contestants. The whole aim of election observation activities is to provide the recommendations, whether to, of course, if it's necessary, whether how is it possible to improve the legislation, to bring it to in more closer compliance with the international standards, with the international public law, and to bring the electoral practices to make the elections free and fair. We use it. Many people are using this stamp, actually. The important stuff, and we actually always declare it from the very beginning of our activities in the countries, that we do not actually validate any election results. We do not consult the participants on how to behave, how to hold the elections. Are the elections really kind of provided in favor of one or another contestants? No, it's not our aim, and we are trying to avoid this involvement, actually. But the process, the technical, usually the, mostly technical and potentially at times political process are really the fields of our interests. We do not recognize the elections kind of as the elections are democratic or not. It was actually quite well spread understanding and even practice that ODIHR and some other European institutions were kind of saying, yes, we recognize that the elections were democratic and in line with, for example, international commitments. But for some years, I would say maybe for some 10 years already, we do not make such conclusions. We do not assess whether the elections are free and fair. We do not say that, yes, elections are democratic, but we just highlight and assess whether different aspects of the electoral process did comply with the standards. If you speak about the legal grounds for election observation by ODIHR, this is actually a Copenhagen document which was signed in 1990. And this document, as I said already, established a quite certain set of criteria for any elections to be called or to be perceived as genuine and democratic elections. From the very beginning, the Office for Free Elections, our institution was called in such a manner. It was just mandated just to collect the information among all the participating states from the very beginning, and to analyze, or firstly analyze the legal framework. But in 1992, the mandate was expanded. This office for free elections was actually mandated to assess all aspects of human dimension security. Human dimension of security issues. It was turned to Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights, and later the mandate for observation was explicitly expanded for so-called long-term observation. We will speak about it a bit later. Then in 1994, also media monitoring component was introduced and designated as necessary component of election monitoring activities. And finally, the latest change of the mandate was actually admitted and confirmed by participating states in 1999 in Istanbul, where all the participating states agreed to follow up promptly to the recommendations provided by ODIHR based on the election observation activities. Actually, this is so-called follow-up stage of the election observation activities, and we are quite active in this direction now, but we will speak about it a bit later. And if to be extremely, if to have an extremely legalistic approach, actually the possibility to observe the elections in participating states and OSCE participating states is provided by the paragraph number 8. Which has some problems in implementation in different countries. Actually, it's not only to the east, but to the west of Vienna as well. Also, there are more than 20, I think actually 25 years of this documents, of presence of this document. But we still, not fight actually, but really face some problems in some countries. To provide and to legalize possibility to observe elections, not only by international community, by ourselves, but by citizens, by domestic observers from inside the country. So let's have a look, let's come to standards. Actually, what are the standards and what it is actually standards for democratic elections? So any election observation activities is actually limited to assessment whether the state meet the OSCE commitments. It does not, it's not limited only to the election, but also to respect to the human rights, to the political freedoms, to fundamental freedoms, let's call it in such a way, freedom of speech, freedom of media, freedom of conscience, access to information is one of the latest, more or less, I would say, valid developments in election observation activities. Also, for some 10 years, I think, the concept of respect of the universal standards of respect of human rights are also incorporated in election observation methodology. And we are actually assessing not only adherence to the OSCE Copenhagen document, but also to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, to different regional tools, and national legislation as well. Maybe, may I ask you? Maybe for some ice breaking, not be so, how to say, academic. Maybe just divide our group into two parts. And may I ask each of our parts just to have a small discussion, maybe for 5 minutes, seven, not more. Could you please find some words? Could you maybe? Please find some words how to describe whether. Thank you very much. Actually, I think maybe you need, you don't need myself actually the presentation anymore. You definitely understand and feel what should it be and how should be the elections. But let's just go to kind of classic or academician approach. So periodic, the election should be periodic. Yes, we didn't mention it here, but it's one of the legalistic approaches to the elections. Actually, this principle is provided in the OSCE Copenhagen document. where the participating states agreed that the election should be provided in a reasonable periodic manner, and all the authorities elected should be re-elected in after a certain period of time. Yes, of course, we understand that the principle of periodicality of the elections is cannot be assessed during certain or specific elections, but actually this benchmark is assessed by election observation activities, missions, and so on, while assessing the legal framework, especially constitution, the codes or laws which govern the periodic conducting of the elections, and so on. Then we said already that the elections should be universal, but universal has at least two dimensions. First of all eligible voters, as we said already, should be provided with the possibility to vote, but not only provided not only from practical point of view, kind of to get to the polling stations, to get information where is the polling station or voting center in different countries, it differs. But actually there should be no discrimination provided by the legislation and especially by practice to any group of voters. Maybe a couple of, examples to provide to feel what it is, universality of the elections. Actually, candidates cannot be discriminated to stand for elections, so there shouldn't be unreasonable conditions, like a candidate for presidency should serve at least two previous terms in the office, or he or she should be of two academy degrees, and so on. There shouldn't be provided language barriers to candidates. The national minority issues should be respected, and a lot of different stuff. But actually, the main sense of the universal principle of elections, the lack of any discrimination. It sounds actually quite vivid and usual, but I would say that we really face a lot of problems and instances when this principle is not met, or is a bit avoided by participating states, and actually not only kind of some extreme cases with only one candidate forever, but actually in European countries also there is now such a development and a legal discussion which has been actually concluded already. Quite a couple of years ago, the European Court on Human Rights decreed that it is a form of discrimination to ban or to limit the persons, the people with mental disabilities from participating in elections. I don't remember actually the legislation in the Czech Republic yet, but many countries set up such a kind of universal ban that yes, the voters, eligible voters are those who reached 18 years or 16 years in some countries, who are not, for example, serving a prison sentence or some other limits, and also are not recognized by the court as incapable. Actually, the European Court on Human Rights and the Committee on Human Rights and the UN Committee, they ruled and promote now this line that only a specific individual court case could provide a possibility to disenfranchise people. There shouldn't be any universal bans on special groups not to participate in the elections. Equal. Yes, equality of the elections is one of the pillars we just touched upon a bit. Actually, equality of the rights should be provided to voters. First of all, each voter should have the same right to participate in the elections, and each voter should have the same weight of his or her vote. There shouldn't be use or possibilities in the electoral system when one voter, for example, can cast the same elections. We mean two ballots, or, for example, vote at different polling stations, while others or rest voters are not entitled to vote at all. Equality of the elections in this specific manner is actually linked to, maybe you heard about this famous gerrymandering phenomena. Actually, the equality of the elections should be really be taken into account while redistricting the constituencies, the electoral districts, because actually every candidate, I mean, for example, it's especially valid for parliamentary elections, every candidate should have approximately the same support or at least electorate to be supported by, to avoid possibilities that one candidate can, for example, get some 10,000 votes, while a second in another constituency should travel around half of the vote and get at least 500,000 voters from, I don't know, from everywhere. So the equality means equal right of each voters to to influence the results. But also the equality, the principle of equality is provided to all candidates. All candidates should be in absolutely equal position to stand for elections and to campaign, to have equal opportunities, not not to have equal campaign, but to have equal opportunities to campaign. It means that the people should enjoy the public, actually not the public, I mean fundamental freedoms, so that every voter could attend the rallies, the meetings, the campaign events, I don't know what whatsoever. The candidates or political parties should have equal opportunities to access to media and use other forms of potential information of voters. Fair. I said already. Let's take it fair. Actually, this word is used in the OSCE Copenhagen document in the preamble of this sixth paragraph. I will not bother you with these details, but actually, the participating states that yes, they respect the rights of the people to choose to elect. I don't remember exactly the word, but actually to elect their government in free and free, fair, and impartial manner. But I said already that we do not assess and we do not call whether the elections were fair or not, because you understand that fairness is quite a subjective criteria, and actually it's quite easy to manipulate this term or meaning of this word. That's why we do not assess and we do not say yes, the elections were fair. But of course, all our assessments are linked and going around this word, whether the conditions for candidates were fair and equal, equal enough and respectively fair for all participants, where the voters were and could have an informed choice about all the political options, and therefore whether the elections were fair for the voters, whether the counting was clear, open, transparent and honest, and again we can speak about the fair election in this context. So it's kind of such a word aggregating several of the several other principles for elections. Secrecy, yes. Actually, even in Europe, it's the secrecy in in overall approach is not treated in the same way. But we should understand that the choice of a voter should be secret, not because he doesn't want to express his priorities or kind of respect to different political parties or different platforms. No. The secrecy of the vote should be is definitely connected to the security dimension of the elections as well, because it's also in the Copenhagen documents. It is said that the voters should have an opportunity to choose freely and free of fear of retribution. So any voter should cast their vote and be absolutely confident and sure that he or she will not be treated as, I don't know, as a right person, treated as he or she made the right decision or something like this. No, it's his or her own decision whether to disclose their choice or not. But I would tell even more. it is not allowed. Actually, this good electoral practice does not allow for voters to express their choice openly during the election day at the polling stations. It's, yes, of course, it's my decision. Yes, I voted for Mr. I don't know whom, Mr. A, and say, guys, I have voted for Mr. A. Maybe it's fine. Yes, we actually do not push other voters to make a choice or conclusion or whatsoever. But usually, and it happens actually not in OSCE region, but also in African region and Asian countries, that this kind of self-disclosure is actually a form of declaring to the government, to the management, electoral management bodies, yes, you should actually swear that you, support a candidate. And this is very widely used as a form of intimidation, first of all, of intimidation of voters. So in order to provide and to avoid this possibility in general, the OSCE participating states agree that the voting should be secret. And actually this principle is also contained in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. The political decision should be secret. Free. The election should be free. We spoke already about it. We do not assess whether the elections were really free. It's also kind of an aggregation category. And we, first of all, understand that the voters should be provided with opportunities to freely cast their votes without any pressure, without any vote buying scheme, without any illegal practices to kind of to engage people in voting. The candidates should be free to stand to express their opinions, and as well they should be free not to stand for the elections. Actually, it sounds a bit strange, but for example, maybe you will be surprised, in Norway, in the Kingdom of Norway, there are quite long-standing constitutional traditions, but actually if some voters nominated and expressed a wish to nominate a person for a candidate, he cannot reject. So the standing for elections at a certain period, at a certain stage, is obligatory in Norway. We are actually criticizing this strange, I would say, not very well famous phenomena for quite a long time. Actually, the authorities and even the parliament, they agree that there are some problems in this very strange provision. But this provision is fixed in the constitution, and the constitution of Norway is one of the most rigid constitution in the world. It is necessary to have at least two consecutive terms of different parliaments to vote for potential changes in the constitution. So they are trying, yes, we are trying, but it's still some 10 years at least should take place. And actually they are not trying to do it, but there is such a strange and interesting case actually in electoral practice in Europe. So the election should be transparent. I said already that, yes, first of all, it's necessary to provide clear rules for everybody. And the transparency is the main issue, the main mechanism, the main driver for making the rules clear and universal for everybody. But transparency of the preparations of the activities is a crucial component or aspects for building the public confidence. Actually, I think you will agree that to a certain extent, maybe not many people care how the elections were organized. Yeah? Who, maybe even especially for local elections, maybe for some types of parliamentary elections, maybe the people do not care who is actually winning a seat in a parliament or in a local council or something like this. But the people and the main staff, the main outcome of the election, that the population, the people, maybe the main stakeholders should be absolutely sure that the elections do really reflect the will of the people. And actually there were no manipulations, no problems, no kind of concerns about the real outcomes of the elections. And the transparency of each and every step in organization of the elections is a crucial component for building public confidence. If you followed several so-called color revolutions, yes, in the Asian part of former Soviet Union, and actually in Eastern Europe, some of countries, actually many revolutions were detonated by the problem that there were no public confidence in the election results, especially when these revolutions or some events were happening right after the elections. Because if the system, if the government, if the, okay, let's call it not government, but the system does not provide the public confidence of the results, something should be changed. Usually, or quite often, this something turns out to be the government. And accountability. Actually, this is this linked very much to the transparency, so each step not should be just opened, okay guys, yes, you see we counted, but we just then destroyed all the materials, put the ballots, I don't know, into a fire or something like this. No, each step should be accountable, and each contestant actually, or each participant should be provided with the possibility to challenge any activities, whether it is linked to inclusion to the voter list, or is it connected to candidate registration, or for example, providing equal opportunities for access to media and so on and so on, and of course to the counting and tabulation procedures. So these are eight main principles, eight actually words which describe any elections, and if an election does meet or does or can be described with these attributes actually, so we in general we can say that the elections were democratic from the perspective of the OSCE Copenhagen document and actually ODIHR methodology. I touched upon several areas, yes, and maybe I would like to aggregate. So when we are observing the elections and preparing our final report and recommendations, we are assessing, as you see, even 11 fields, separate fields, which shows actually that the elections is not such an easy deal. Yes, everybody knows that we can cast the vote and everybody will be happy. But the electoral process is quite a lengthy process, and it is still actually contested by several OSCE participating states when they discuss or try to limit activity. And to a certain extent, it's also connected to a fairness of the elections, whether all the elections do enjoy the same possibilities to hold rallies, to have an access to media, and no, I think not. To a lesser extent to free elections. Campaign finance, it's actually one of the newest trends in election observation activities, I mean in the fields of interest of election observation activities. You know, of course, and first of all, the interest to campaign finance is linked to the manner and conducting of the elections in the United States, where the money really does make a lot, and does really affect the outcome of elections. Actually, the United States were maybe one of the first countries who admitted and said, yes, it is necessary to provide maybe not regulation, because the US actually do not regulate the campaign finance as such. But these aspects should be really taken into account by all participating stakeholders, because really non-transparent or maybe illegal campaign finance can really affect not only the election results but further activities of the government elected. Yeah, and campaign finance is field of interest is one of the newest for development. We actually released the special handbook on campaign finance observation this year in January 2015. This is the area of concern in many, if not a majority, of European countries as well. Then the role of media, yes, we understand, but of course we shouldn't speak about only access to media by the contestants, but also a universal approach and actually the mandate of the media to serve as a watchdog for democratic elections, for democratic governance, for any processes which actually contribute to election and creation of a new government. Then we spoke about already universal principles of the elections, whether no forms of discrimination should be allowed and or should be provided by both legal framework and practices. And actually, the participating of national minorities and women in the elections are two of actually aspects which are really followed by our missions. We do try to assess whether the women and certain national minorities, if it is the case for a country, are really provided with equal opportunities to participate in the elections, and moreover, whether they are provided with some maybe not favorite conditions to participate, because in many countries and including the European, actually, it's necessary to promote or even to provide more efforts to enhance participation of women or national minorities in the electoral process. Then electoral disputes is linked to also to fairness of the elections and accountability of the elections. Actually, each participant should have an opportunity to challenge any problem or potential problem or perceived problem. But the system of the electoral dispute should not kind of get rid of all these complaints. I say maybe come up the next year, maybe we will consider your complaint. No. The system of effective legal address should be provided and created by the state. Actually, in different countries, the electoral dispute system differs quite dramatically, I would say. In some countries, only the court, judiciary is in charge of electoral dispute resolution, and some other administrative bodies are in charge, for example, electoral commissions. In third countries, even independent bodies, which are actually which comprise both judiciary, election administration, and civil society representatives. So there is a really mixture of different types, but we definitely should understand that the system should provide the effective legal redress to any participant in the election. Election day procedures as such, of course, we follow the technical aspects of the elections, and actually all the principles, all the guidelines for democratic elections could be really seen and observed in quite a condensed manner during the election day, whether the voters can vote freely. Enter the polling stations, make the vote in secrecy, whether they have and are provided with additional or substantial information to make an informed choice, to provide the counting in an honest and impartial manner, and so on. And the last, but not the least, aspect is use or implementation of new voting technologies. Actually, maybe some 5 years ago, this was even more dynamic. The use of new voting technologies was more dynamic in OSCE region, now to a less extent. But just for you to have an overall perception, why is it so, not so important, because it is still observed within all these eight guiding principles. But we have now three more or less general new voting technologies, when the voters can vote without a paper ballot, either through touchscreen machines or via internet, so voting electronically. And the third aspect of new voting technologies implemented is automatic electronic registration of the voters. Actually, it's not only registration, but also mark-off options. When the voters are not signing, or yes, maybe they sign the voter list, but they are also registered in the electronic databases, which operate from time to time on a nationwide or maybe region-wide system. But the use of this technology actually provides a possibility to avoid so-called multiple voting. But it's really very tricky. It can be really tricky when the errors or maybe some problems or even intentional algorithms in this automatic voter registration could actually enfranchise some people or even some groups of people. So, and now let's go to the types of election, different types of election observation activities. Actually, maybe some of you heard already or saw, but we have two main, I would say, observation handbooks, yes, or we call it just blue book. This is a handbook, election observation handbook, represents actually the methodology of ODIHR for election observation activities, for all election observation activities provided by our institution. We were mandated to establish, to develop and provide the methodology by the 1994 Council of Ministers decision, and this is, I wouldn't say, of course, it's not a legal tool, but first of all, it's legal tool for us to organize the elections, to conduct the elections, to report on elections. It's our, let's call it Bible, and it does cover activities of all members of all missions we are deploying in different countries, and also it contains a so-called code of conduct, the main prohibitions, limitations to election observers. They should adhere to during the election observation mission. And actually, there is one more handbook for long-term election observers. This is a follow-up for the Blue Book, but it is linked or concentrated mostly on the field activity of observers in the regions, especially when the observers are deployed as long-term observers to cover different aspects region-wise. And now, just a couple of words. So methodology is not kind of frozen. Yes, we had already six editions of this blue book, of the methodology as such. But the latest trend that we do provide a special, quite narrow explanation of what is assessed, why certain areas of election preparations are assessed in one or another manner, and we provide different handbooks for different areas related to the elections. And actually the latest handbooks were, I said already, campaign finance observation and participation of women in this is actually participation of national minorities, but also participation of women. There was a separate handbook released by ODIHR lately. But now, okay, one more. The whole methodology, and if you are really interested to see and to feel, if you by chance or by your own wish are planning to become a long-term observer or short-term observer, I would really encourage to write down the name of this internet website, the www.stuelearning.org. It's actually our online course for election observers. We are now developing this course, and we hope by September, so in 3 months, it's actually in our plan to expand this course and to make separate items for short-term observers and for long-term observers. This course provides a lot of practical issues. I wouldn't cover it today, of course, but really it describes several situations, security-wise, politically-wise, potential discussion of media issues and so on. So really very interesting and very, very helpful course. If you are interested in a way, yes, please you could register and just follow the methodology. But now I will go to types, different types of activities. We have not a lot of time. So, may I ask a question to you? Did you hear any different types of activities? Could some of you just name what missions can be deployed in OSCE region? Just try to guess. No. And did anybody participate in election observation within ODIHR? Yes, and in what capacity?
As a long-term observer.
Long-term observers. Uh-huh. So I think you were in a limited election observation mission, or maybe in election observation mission, yeah?
I think it was election observation.
I see. Yes. If it's Serbia, then definitely election observation mission. Okay, then. So you understand that a level of development of electoral practice in different countries is absolutely different. Moreover, I wouldn't say only about technical or legal development of the electoral practice, but also by political, by cultural aspects. Historical aspects do really affect organization of the elections. And therefore, of course, it's not possible to use one schablon, one approach to all the countries. Also, this approach of ODIHR is at times heavily criticized by some of our partners, by some participating states. They try to call it kind of double standards or what, in other terms. I wouldn't go into these details because it's more or less politically biased, I would say, discussion. But we actually provided, I think, already 350 different election observation activities for these 20 years of observation. And we really collected some institutional memory, and we could assess and aggregate our efforts. We were at times really criticized for ineffective use of money, because of course everybody understands that we cannot provide election observation just for free or just for on a voluntary basis. It's quite expensive activity. But as any activities related to spending of money, especially of public money, we should provide more or less, effective spending, effective spending of the money. And also taking into account an effective use of money and maybe effective an added value of potential election observation activities, we derived actually to four different types of election observation activities. I'll start with the last one. This is election observation mission, limited election observation mission, election assessment mission, and election expert team. Just to open the acronyms. So election observation mission, it is so-called full-fledged observation activity, which is provided if there are legal, political, and problems in elections when the interlocutors do raise concerns about whether all this, whether all these eight guiding principles for elections are really respected in the country. Election observation mission is deployed when there is a definite need to observe the election day procedures. So if a country or a system does not provide for a public confidence in how the election day procedures are provided, whether the counting and tabulation is provided in an impartial and honest manner, we usually deploy election observation mission. Election observation mission has actually three layers, three main stages of observation. The core team of specialists who actually cover different aspects, legal framework, election administration, voter registration, and so on, is composed for each of these election observation mission. It usually includes political analysts, election analysts, legal analysts, media analysts, and some other, maybe national minorities, gender analysts. The core team comprises also a coordinator of long-term observers. And operation, security, financial experts who provide, rolling the normal activities of the observation mission. But this is a small and, I would say, tiny part of the election observation mission structure. The main, and I would say we call it actually the ears and the eyes of the mission, is composed at the second level, so core team. Long-term observers. Ah, yes, if you speak about who are core team members, the members for the core team are chosen through an open competition. The advertisement for for employment of core team members for a certain specific mission is provided at our website. We do provide a certain, at times short, at times longer period for applications. Everybody, every citizen of OSCE participating states can apply. And actually, if he or she does provide necessary expertise and the level of maybe background, education, experience, first of all, experience, this person can be engaged in a capacity of a core team member. But the practice differs with the long-term observers. We are not selecting, we are not choosing the long-term observers. They are seconded, they are deployed by the participating states. Actually, when participating states mandated and provided a mandate for election observation for ODIHR, they also committed, yes, that they do participate in election observation activities as well through secondment of long-term and short-term observers. And actually, we do not form the second level of the specialists. It is provided by the states. But this, the long-term observers do provide this so-called geographic diversity of the team. And I would say that some complaints, they are really valid. For example, yes, it can be perceived, especially perceived as biased mission, if, for example, members of or citizens of only one or maybe a couple of countries are providing the expertise of the whole legislation, practice, and so on. Yes, it can be perceived as a biased or maybe kind of use of double standards or maybe national, I don't know, interests and so on and so on. So we are really trying to avoid potential potential reproaches and so on, and really usually at least 10, 15 or even more countries are represented actually by the citizens within the core team and long-term observers. And the largest, actually the long-term observers spend usually some 6-8 weeks in the region, and they are our ears and eyes. They do communicate with all interlocutors. They speak to voters, to candidates, to political parties' offices, to media, local, regional media, to the election administration as well. They do follow the election day procedures during the election day to a lesser extent, but they do make a follow-up visits after the election day when the documents are collected, packed, or delivered to a body, I don't know, in what country what happens. Also, long-term observers provide quite an essential part of operational staff. Actually, they are preparing the conditions for deployment of short-term observers who represent the third level of election observation activities, of election observation mission. Short-term observers are appear or show up only in election observation mission. So they can serve only in this type of missions. They are also seconded by the states, but only for 1 week. So usually it's 3 or 4 days before the election day, as such, and a couple of days after the election, the short-term observers stay in the country. They are briefed quite thoroughly. We brief them with regards to political context of the elections, election administration issues which happened before the election, the election day procedures, how it should be actually followed or should be provided according to the national legislation, and we provide the short-term observers with reporting forms. We explain how to form, how to fill the forms, and actually observation of short-term observers on election day, their reporting forms serve as a separate, I mean, the base, not the base actually, the only data which we are using to provide a separate section in our report as election day procedures. So all our observation on election day are reflected in the preliminary statement of findings. They are publicized on the next day after the election day and usually do represent, okay, let's not call it political, but substance-wise assessment of the elections, whether the elections were or could be called democratic, whether they do comply with the guiding principles, we spoke about it, and whether the electoral practice do comply with the international commitments. And a little bit shorter about limited election observation mission. Actually, this is almost the same, the similar activities Also, the limited election observation mission stays in the country for some couple of months, for some 2 months, but it is deployed without short-term observers. Actually, we make such a decision to send a limited election observation mission in countries where there are either no problems at all, I mean, no potential problems with the election day procedures, and when the interlocutors, when the main participants in the elections do not question the integrity of the election day procedures. If the electoral administration works fine, if the results are delivered transparently and honestly, so there is no need to follow the election day observation, the election day activities. But we do still observe the implementation of the international standards. We do communicate with all interlocutors. We assess the political background and everything which is actually valid for the election observation activity, but without short-term observers. There are some exceptions. There are some exceptions. Maybe if you followed, maybe not. We provided two limited election observation missions in Uzbekistan in December 2014 and just in March in 2015. And of course, some people say, oh, you see such a great development, democracy and so on in Uzbekistan. No. The decision was actually taken under absolutely reverse conditions. We definitely understood, and all interlocutors say that we do not believe what is going on the election day or at the polling stations. The results are quite mysteriously delivered by. Actually, I would say that we didn't receive, actually, this was the same situation in Tajikistan. So the Central Electoral Commission just published the results, kind of. Mr. Karimov got 97%, full stop, nothing more. No data how many voters were voting. No aggregated data or disaggregated data how different regions voted. Nothing. Just turnout, 95%, I think, and results, 97%, full stop. That's it. And of course, in such situation, we passed a decision that there is no added value actually to observe this election day procedures. Why? Because no principles are adhered by the system. But we still deploy the limited election observation to see, to provide potential recommendations and to try to encourage the state actually to try to improve the situation. But the reforms, especially electoral reforms, are not very quick business, definitely. Then where, LEOM, limited election observation missions, are deployed to the countries where there are certain problems, concerns in different aspects, in almost all aspects regulating the elections. But if only certain or some specific concerns or novelties, for example, new legislation was introduced just before the elections, or some problems need some further expertise and maybe detailed regulations and so on, or some interlocutors raise some concerns, guys, maybe we are not so happy with this new voting technologies or campaign finance or something like this, we deploy election assessment mission or election expert teams. It depends actually on the scale, whether more fields of interest should be reflected or should be observed by EAM, and less only specific areas should be observed by electoral expert teams. But the main feature that these teams stay two, three, maximum 4 weeks in the country. We do not make a public statement, yes, the election were kind of in line with standards or something like this after the election day. But in some 2 months after the elections, we provide a final report. The main idea of which is not only to reflect what was going on during the elections, but actually to provide the recommendations, how to improve the legal framework and the shortages or negative aspects of the elections observed by our mission. I think that's it from my side. We are running out of the time. If you have questions, please, you are welcome. And again, if you are really interested to participate to a certain extent in our observation activities, again, I would draw your attention to this very useful resource.